మానిటర్ కావాలి. గ్రేషియస్ అండ్ హెవెన్లీ ఫాదర్, థ్యాంక్ యూ ఫర్ ద సాక్రిఫైస్ దట్స్ ఆన్ ద క్రాస్. థ్యాంక్ యూ ఫర్ ద లవ్ దట్ యు హావ్ బెస్టోడ్ అపాన్ అస్. థ్యాంక్ యూ ఫర్ ద ఫర్గివ్నెస్ దట్ యు హావ్ గ్రాంటెడ్ అన్ టు అస్. థ్యాంక్ యూ ఫర్ ద ఇటర్నల్ లైఫ్ దట్ యు హావ్ గిఫ్టెడ్ టు అస్. అండ్ థ్యాంక్ యూ ఫర్ ద జాయ్ ఆఫ్ సాల్వేషన్. అండ్ థ్యాంక్ యూ ఫర్ ద పీస్ దట్ పాస్డ్ ఆల్ అండర్స్టాండింగ్. Thank you for the fellowship that you have granted to us. And thank you for every blessing that we are able to enjoy day-to-day life. And also thank you for the word that you have given to us. And thank you for the sermons that you are speaking to each one of us. As we have come together to study your word, Spirit of God, we pray in the name of Jesus, speak to us. Father God, as you love us, I pray that you will minister unto us, that we may understand your word, your will, and that we practice your word. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen. Friends, can you turn your Bibles to Book of Ruth, chapter 2, Tremble Gavalayam. Book of Ruth, chapter 2. I'm reading it from verse 3. So she went out and began to glean in the fields behind the harvesters. As it turned out, she found herself working in a field belonging to Boaz, who was from the clan of Elimelech. Just then, Boaz arrived from Bethlehem and greeted the harvesters. The Lord be with you. The Lord bless you, they called back. Boaz asked the foreman of his harvesters, whose young woman is this? The foreman replied, she is the Moabitess who came back from Moab with Naomi. She said, please let me glean and gather among the sheaves behind the harvesters. She went into the field and has worked steadily from morning till now, except for a short rest in the shelter. Then Boaz said to Ruth, my daughter, listen to me. Don't go and glean in another field, and don't go away from here. Stay here with my servant girls. Watch the field where the men are harvesting and follow along after the girls. I've told the men not to touch you. And whenever you are thirsty, go and get a drink from the water jars the men have filled. Dear brothers and sisters, we're studying about a woman whose life was helpless, hopeless, and husbandless. Her heart was empty, her stomach was empty, and the house was empty, and the hands were empty. And she has no idea from where in the world that she is going to get a job. And she was a jobless. She was penniless and she was a friendless, and yet she had great hope for tomorrow. Great hope for tomorrow. Brothers and sisters, many times I've gone through many, many torturing situations. I've gone through financial crises many times in my life. I've gone to many criticisms, Many people criticized me. Many people complained against me. Many people condemned me. Many people tried to assassinate my character. I've gone through all this throughout my life. I've gone through situations that were very discouraging, very disappointing. And at times, devil comes and tells me, why do you still live among all these problems and all these tensions and all this stress, all this criticism? Why do you still live? The best way is to die. How many times devil came to me and told me that I should die? You are not worth living. You can't face these problems. You can't face these enemies. You can't face this criticism. You can't face this financial crisis. I've gone through all these things. As I was going through this, I read a book. In that book, I read a wonderful story that gave me hope. The story goes like this. King so loved the entire kingdom and called all the people and said, take whatever you want. I want my people to be happy. I don't want my people to go through the financial crisis, debts, disappointment, dismayed conditions. Take whatever you want. And he gave all his treasures. Finally, the minister came and said, King, you know what? Our entire treasure, our treasury, was emptied. There is nothing that we own it now. Everything was given away. We don't have anything in the treasure now. The king said, don't worry. I have retained one of the most and precious thing in my life. Then the minister thought maybe some diamonds or maybe expensive jewelry or maybe some hidden treasures that he has hidden. So the minister asked him, what is the most important and precious thing that you have retained? The king said, today you see everything is empty. Yes. Today you see everything is over. Yes, sir. But I have hope for tomorrow. I have hope for tomorrow. Tomorrow is going to come and it's going to bring blessing to us. So I trust that tomorrow is going to be a better day, a best day, and that's going to bring best blessing to us. When I read this story, I always remember, whenever I go through many problems and stresses and disappointing situations and helpless conditions and crisis, I always believe one thing, tomorrow is coming. And I have hope in tomorrow. Is there anybody going through the same situation today? The devil comes and disappoints you. The devil comes and discourages you, saying that, why do you still live? It is better for you to die. You can't face this problem. You can't face the blames. You can't face the rumors spreading against you in the office. You can't face such horrible people. They are stupids. They will rip you down. They will strip you down. You can't face them. Better quit your life. Maybe you are going through such a situation, but I want to tell you something. The one who is in you is far greater than the one who is troubling you outside. The one who loves you is far greater than the one who hates you. The one who wants you to live is far greater than the one who wants to kill you. The one who wants to give you future is far mightier than the one who wants to destroy your present life. All that you need to do, stop looking at your enemy. Start look at your friend who loves you more than himself. His name is Jesus. And whenever devil comes and discourages me, do you know what I do? I look unto Jesus. And Jesus always smiles at me. Whenever I go through the storms, I look unto Jesus and I see Jesus smiles at me. What I mean by this? Many people traveling in a ship, as they were traveling through the ship, all of a sudden the ship was caught in the midst of the storm. The waves were roaring and hitting against the ship. And the ship was shaking here and there. And finally, people understood that they're going to die. And they understood the ship is going to sink. That day is going to be the day that they are going to be buried in the water. As everyone screaming and shouting and screaming and shouting and crying unto God, holding each other, terrified and horrified by seeing bad weather, one young man decided in spite of bad weather and the stormy weather, he wanted to go and see the captain of the ship. Let me go and see the captain of the ship. Is he tensed? Is he struggling to handle the ship? Is he sweating, unable to know what to do? Let me go and see him. So in spite of this bad weather, in spite of everybody's crying, he wanted to go and open the cabin room and wanted to speak to the captain. As he walked close, as he opened the door of the captain's cabin and he looked at the cabin's face, the captain looked at him like this. And he smiled and said, "Young man, how are you?" He was shocked. The captain was smiling. The moment when he saw the captain's smile, he ran to the people and said, "We all are stupids. We are unnecessarily crying. We will not die." Everybody says, "Look at the storm. Look at those waves. They're going to kill us." The young man says, "You are looking at the waves, you are looking at the storm, but I looked at the face of the captain. He was smiling." The reason why he was smiling is the entire ship is in his control and he knows the ship will not sink in the water. Why should we cry when we see the captain's face smiling? Dear brothers and sisters, are you going through a situation that you can't control? Are you going through a storm that is quenching you, that is burying you with fears? Stop looking at the storms. Look at the captain. He's smiling at you. The reason why he is smiling at you, do you know why? He says, "Everything is in my control. Nothing is going to happen to you. No storm can hit you against. You will not die because I'm in control." That is what God is telling you this evening. Stop looking at the storms. Stop looking at those people who are threatening you. Stop looking at the situations which are helpless and hopeless. Look unto the one who can take care of your future. That is what Ruth did in her life. She didn't look around. There was nothing. She didn't look around people because there was nobody to help. She didn't even look at herself because she was a widow. She didn't even look at the house because everything was empty. She didn't look at the mother-in-law because she herself was a widow. She didn't look at the vessels because vessels were empty. But do you know where she looked at? She looked at God. The moment when the mother-in-law, Naomi, said, go back to your parents, go back to your country, go back to your gods, live your life. Ruth said, "No, I will not go back to my country. I will not go back to my parents. I will not go back to my former gods. Why? Ruth said, your God is my God. Now she began looking at that God. My God, my God, you are my God. I don't have hope. Hopeless, helpless. But I look unto you. I don't know where, from where in the world I can get job. I don't know where in the world people will help me. I have no one known to me in this place. I'm a new person. It's a new journey. It's a new day. I have no idea where you will take me. But Lord, I surrender myself, my life, my future into your hands. Please take care of me. With hope in God, with trust in God, she stepped out empty-handed, empty-hearted. But do you know what happened? When she trusted God, when she rested in God, do you know where she went? As she was searching for fields where she could glean, she found a field full of harvesters. Slowly, slowly, slowly she walked into the field. There were many fields. Many fields belongs to many people. There were many workers and harvesters. But she got into one field and she went to the foreman and said, can I glean in this field? I'm a widow. I'm a widow. I'm a foreigner. I don't have anyone to take care of me. Will you please let me glean after harvesters, please? Very humble. Down to earth. She knew her situation. She knew the condition at home. And she was so humble, she went and asked, can I glean behind the harvesters? I'm a poor woman, a widow, please. So the foreman said, yes, you can go and glean. Go. And she started gleaning behind the harvesters. Then comes a man by name Boaz. The Bible says he was very rich man. Very rich man. Not only he was a rich man, he was a relative to Naomi's husband. He was born in the same clan of Elimelech. That's what the Bible says. He was a rich man. Rich not only in terms of money, rich also in terms of spirituality. He was a very spiritual man. Very rich man. Very spiritual man. How can we say that? He was a spiritual man. Look what the Bible says. He was a very spiritual man. How can we say that? Second chapter. Fourth verse. Just then, Boaz arrived from Bethlehem and greeted the harvesters, the Lord be with you. The first word that came out of this rich man is this, the Lord be with you. Many times, do you know what happens? When we are poor, when we are financially crushed, when we go through sickness, when we go through problems and pains, we are very close to God. Every day, 3 times we kneel down and pray. Every time the name of Jesus will be always
on the top of your tongue for everything, every time you call upon Jesus, the name of Jesus. Jesus, I need you. Jesus, please help me. Jesus, I want you. Jesus, you are everything to me. The reason why? Because you're helpless. Because you're jobless. Because you're healthless. Because of many problems, you're so close to God. And you will be the first person to attend God's service, God's church. You will be the first person to sit in Calvary Temple. You will not miss fasting prayers. Sometimes you will even attend 5 services. Why? Because of so many problems. You feel that only God's presence can console you. You feel only God's presence can comfort you. You feel only God's word can encourage you. That's the reason you read Bible. That's the reason you pray every time. That's the reason why you are seen in the temple all the time. And then God loves you. Because God loves you. And He wants to remove your tears. Wipe away your tears. Remove your fears. And bless your life. Bless you fiscally. Bless you financially. Bless you in every direction so that you will be much more closer to Him and you may become blessing to others. And that's the reason why God blessed you with job. That's the reason why God gave you promotion. That's the reason why God granted you hike in your salary. That's the reason why God made you a team leader, a manager, or even a general manager, or managing director, or CEO, or the top in that company. Blessed your business. The problem with those people who are being blessed abundantly, most often, do you know what happens? They go away from God with those blessings. Very often, when God starts blessing, when God starts blessing us, the most of the time, we go away from God. We are not seen in the church. We are not seeing praying. We are not seen reading the Bible. We are not seen sharing the gospel and the God's word. Why? You're too busy. Busy with your job. Busy with your responsibilities. Busy with your friends and colleagues and the status. Now you've become rich, influential. Big circle. You'll have breakfast in Mumbai, lunch in Chennai, and sometimes your dinner in Dubai. And you say goodbye to God. Is there anybody like that this evening? Be careful. When God blesses you, don't run with those blessings. It took for you to receive those blessings many, many years. It took many years for you to get job. It took many years for you to get that promotion. It took many years to get that hike in your salary. But if you run away from God with His blessings, it takes a fraction of a second for God to remove that blessing. It takes few minutes for you to lose that job. It takes few minutes to lose that promotion. It takes few minutes to lose that project. It takes few minutes to fall from the place where you are now. If you reject God, God may reject you. Let's be careful. The Bible says, "Turn unto me, I will turn unto you. Come unto me, I will come unto you. Ask me, I will give to you. Honor me, I will honor you. Get away from me, I will get away from you." Be careful. If you are getting away from God, remember the same distance even God is getting away from you. That's the dangerous thing that can ever happen in your life. Be careful. But look at this man called Boaz. He was a rich man in that city or in the town. But beside being rich man, he was a spiritual man. God wants to bless you, brothers and sisters, in all the directions, but you got to maintain that balance. As God blesses you, remember that he is blessing you, that you may become blessing to others. God comforts you, not to be comfortable, but to comfort others. Look at this man. The moment when he walked into the field, he was greeting first. It was not the workers who greeted him. It was he, the Boaz, greeted them first. The Lord be with you. The words that speaks that he was a spiritual man. The greeting speaks that he was a spiritual man. Your words, your brothers and sisters, your words will tell people whether you are spiritual or not. Your words, your speech, your tongue will tell you whether you love God, whether you are with God, or whether you are away from God. Boaz's words speaks that he is a spiritual man. The Lord be with you. And look at the staff that he had. Look at the workers that he had. The moment when they saw their boss coming in, the moment when they heard the greeting, "The Lord be with you," everyone got up and said, "The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you." Do you know why they said, "The Lord bless you"? Because they all know, if God blesses this man, he will not hold those blessings, but he will share his blessings with us. Do you understand this? Many times, elderly people, mothers and fathers, they come to me during visiting hours. As they spend a few minutes with me, they will hold my hands. Do you know what they say? "My son, God bless you. My son, God's blessings be upon you." Dear brothers and sisters, whatever I am here, do you know why? Because of those blessings of the elderly people were so abundant upon my life. That's the reason I am here. Let me ask you this. How many people wanted that you must be blessed? There are many people who want you to die. Especially if you are a husband who harasses your wife. Do you know what your wife wants? Because she is unable to tolerate your torture. Though she may not express it outside, but that inside, it is better for this man to die. It is better that he should die. She's not saying that you must be blessed. She's cursing inside that he should die. The same thing with many wives. Because of your harassment, because of your torture, many husbands, they may be cursing in their hearts. "She should die. She should get away from me. I don't want to see her face. I don't want to see her being with me." If that is what people are expecting from you, if that is what your husband, if that is what your wife, sometimes children, they're so disobedient. They really trouble their parents, bring sorrow to their hearts. Sometimes father say and mother says, "I shouldn't have given birth to this boy or this girl. She has become thorn in our flesh." It is not good for you, brother, good for you, sister. Let your parents
bless you. Let your husband bless you. Let your wife bless you. Let people around you bless you. Let the church members bless you. If he is being blessed, he will become blessing to us. He will share his blessing with us. That is what happening with Boaz's life. He was so blessed. Do you know why? Because he shares his blessings to all the people around him. That's why they all are seeking that Boaz must be blessed. Dear brothers and sisters, let people, your friends, your family members, your relatives, those who love you, they should bless you. And you should become blessing to others and people around you. And Boaz was a blessed man. He's a blessing man. Be a blessing. Channel of blessing. The moment when he walked in, the word that he spoke is about God. You cannot separate God and Boaz. They are together. And the same thing God is expecting from you too. Though you are working in MNC company, or in a small company, or in a shopping mall, or wherever, God should be with you and within you. And let no one separate God from you. Let nothing separate God from you. Look at Boaz. He is with God. And God is with him. Even in the field, he speaks about God. And then he notices someone gleaning behind the harvesters. He was a rich man. But do you know? He is watching over a poorest woman. Many times you feel lonely, that no one cares for you, that no one loves you, that no one understands you. Sometimes you feel even God is not interested in you. Sometimes you feel so crushed in your heart, even God has dejected you and rejected you. Is it true? Is it real what you think? No. Ruth stepped out of the house with empty hands, but now she was gleaning behind the harvesters, and see what happened. The eyes of Boaz were upon that poor woman. He asked the worker, the foreman, who is she? Who is she? The foreman said, she is a Moabitess, a daughter-in-law of Naomi, a young woman. Okay. What else? She came to me and beseeched me that she may glean in our field. Okay. Master, I have observed her. Do you know what? She came in the morning. Till now, she was just minding her job. She never spoke a word with anyone. She never messed with anyone, mixed with anyone, disturbed anyone. I was observing the entire day. She was just mindful about her job. Few minutes she took rest under the shelter, again came back and started working. Especially when a beautiful woman joins in a new job, everyone will watch. Is it true? They will watch about the dress. They will see how she dresses up, how she walks, how she talks, how she looks. There will be more observation during the first days of her job or his job. Now, Ruth's life, that was the first day. And sometimes we think, brothers, you think only men will watch at women. But let me tell you, women will watch more women.
మీరు ఒప్పుకుంటారు, ఒప్పుకోరమ్మా. ఆడవాళ్ళ కళ్ళు మగాళ్ళ మీద ఉంటాయంటారా, ఆడవాళ్ళ కళ్ళు ఎక్కువ ఆడవాళ్ళ మీద ఉంటాయంటారా? మీరు జాగ్రత్తగా పరిశీలన చేస్తే ఆడవాళ్ళ కళ్ళు ఎక్కువ ఆడవాళ్ళ మీదే ఉంటాయి. ఏం ధరించింది, ఏం కట్టుకుంది, ఏం ఎలా నడుస్తుంది, ఎలా డ్రెస్అప్ అయింది ఎక్కువ. అందుకే సాధారణంగా ఆడవాళ్ళకి ఎవరు శత్రువు అట, ఆడవాళ్ళే శత్రువు అంట. మగాళ్ళకంత ధైర్యమా మీతో శత్రుత్వం పెట్టుకోవడానికి? ఒకవేళ పెట్టుకుంటే బతుకుతారంటారా వాళ్ళు?
ఫ్రెండ్స్,
లుక్ ఎట్ ద రిపోర్ట్, ద ఫస్ట్ డే రిపోర్ట్. ఇట్ వాజ్ ఎ గ్రేట్ రిపోర్ట్, ఇట్ వాజ్ ఎ పాజిటివ్ రిపోర్ట్. ద ఫోర్ మ్యాన్ గివ్స్ ఎ వండర్ఫుల్ రిపోర్ట్ అబౌట్ రూత్. మాస్టర్, ఐ హవ్ సీన్ హర్, ఐ హవ్ అబ్జర్వ్డ్ హర్, షీ ఈజ్ వెరీ ఫోకస్డ్, షీ మైండ్స్ హర్ జాబ్, హర్ ఐస్ వర్ ఫిక్స్డ్ ఆన్ హర్ జాబ్, షీ డస్ నథింగ్ అపార్ట్ ఫ్రమ్ హర్ జాబ్, అండ్ షీ వాజ్ ఆన్ టైమ్ టిల్ ద ఎండ్ ఆఫ్ ద డే. షీ వాజ్ జస్ట్ వర్కింగ్, 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 వర్కింగ్. ఎ పాజిటివ్ రిపోర్ట్. డియర్ బ్రదర్స్ అండ్ సిస్టర్స్, ఐఎమ్ క్లోజింగ్, బట్ బిఫోర్ క్లోజ్ ఐ క్లోజ్. వెన్ సమ్వన్ ఆస్క్స్ అబౌట్ యూ, అబౌట్ యువర్ వర్క్, దేర్ షుడ్ బి పాజిటివ్ రిపోర్ట్. పీపుల్, దోస్ యూ ఆర్ అరౌండ్ యూ, షుడ్ గివ్ ఎ పాజిటివ్ రిపోర్ట్ అబౌట్ యూ. He's a very good gentleman. He doesn't disturb others. She doesn't disturb others. She's very focused. She just minds her job. And second thing we should understand, as I said earlier, she was a beautiful woman, came from foreign country, but very poor and needy. The poor man was looking at her. When you look at her a bad, when you look at a beautiful woman, most often what happens, you will have bad thoughts, you will have bad ideas, bad plans, how to trap her, how to come close to her, how to make friendship with her. So many ideas will be produced when you see a beautiful woman working under you. But dear friends, the beauty about Ruth is this: it can be because of her way that she dressed up. It can be because the way that she humbled herself. It can be the way that she worked. This poor man, he never got a negative idea about that Ruth. He couldn't think a negative way. The moment when he saw her, there was a positive wave, positive thinking. Sometimes when we see some women, the way they dress up, horrible. The moment when you see the way that she dress up, you'll start thinking negatively. The way that they expose their body, the way that they make up themselves, the way that they... very tempting. So it gives a wrong thinking, wrong opinion. I don't want any of my sisters go to your job and give a chance for others to be tempted. When they look at you, they should always have positive thinking. Look at Ruth. When the foreman looked at her, a positive thinking, a positive report. Master, I saw her from the morning. A wonderful report. Very focused, very humble. And she never disturbed other people. And then Boaz calls her. And she says, he says, my daughter. What did he say? My daughter. Don't, my daughter, listen to me. The first thing he said is, listen to me, my daughter. She got questions about tomorrow. Okay, today, okay. Today I got this field. Okay, but tomorrow, where I have to go? Tomorrow, where I have to glean? Tomorrow, where I have to work tomorrow. What's going to happen? There are many people this evening. Too many questions about your future. Too many questions about your job. Too many questions about tomorrow. What's going to happen? How I am going to face tomorrow? How I am going to face tomorrow's tensions? Even Ruth had the same question. How am I going to face tomorrow? Where am I going to find job tomorrow? How am I going to take care of myself and my mother-in-law? Tomorrow, I have no idea what's going to happen. Too many questions. But dear brothers and sisters, she looked unto God. You are my God. You are my God. I am in a country. I am all alone. I have no idea where I have to work. No one is known to me. But only you are my caretaker. With that faith and hope, she stepped out of the house. But now, look what Boaz says. Look what Boaz says. My daughter, listen to me. Don't leave this field. Don't even look at other fields. Be here. Be here. You didn't have to worry about finding a new job. I am giving you a permanent place. This is your place. Be here. You didn't have to worry about your future because I care for your future. Be here, my daughter. You didn't have to go to other fields. Second, if you are thirsty, go and drink from the jars prepared by my workers. You didn't have to work so hard to draw water from the well. Water is ready for you. Not only that, Ruth, I want to tell you something. Yes, sir. I have warned the young people in this city not to touch you, not to be after you, not to trouble you. I have already warned. Boaz knows everything about Ruth, my friends. He has already had great plan for Ruth. Not only plan, for future. Ruth, you don't have to worry about future. It is taken care. You don't have to worry about tomorrow. It is taken care. You are going to glean in this field. Not only that, I have even warned people, those who want to be after you. I have already provided security for you. Provided better days for you. Who is this Boaz? Dear friends, if you study the life of Boaz, you will see Lord Jesus in the life of Boaz. This evening, the same Jesus telling you, don't worry about tomorrow. It is taken care. Don't worry about your future. It's all secured. Don't worry about what's going to happen next. It's all protected. Just obey me. That's what Boaz said. Just obey me. Just listen to me. If only you listen to me. If only you obey me. Ruth, your life is taken care. Your future is taken care. Tomorrow is taken care. If Boaz was so kind to Ruth, how much more our Savior Jesus Christ is concerned about you? Because he loved you so much. If you believe that my Savior is far greater than Boaz and my Savior takes care of my future, why should I be worried? From now onwards, I will just obey my Father, my Savior, and I will press forward without worrying about my future. If this is your decision, will you join with me in prayer? Prathanalu ekki vistava. Naa devudu naa gurinchi aalochistunnadu, naa bhavishyattu gurinchi aalochistunnadu, nenu enduku chintinchali? నా చుట్టూ ఎన్ని తుఫానులు చెలరేగుతున్నప్పటికీ, ఎన్ని ఆపదలు తలెత్తుతున్నప్పటికీ వాటిని చూసి నేను భయపడను. ఎందుకంటే నన్ను నడిపించే దేవుడు
కంట్రోల్ చేస్తున్నాడు సమస్తాన్ని అనే విషయం తెలిసి నేను ముందుకెళ్తాను. భయపడనే భయపడను, దిగులు పడనే దిగులు పడను. నా ప్రభువు వైపు చూస్తూ ముందుకు సాగుతాను, ఎందుకంటే నా ప్రభువు నా గురించి చింతిస్తున్నాడు, ఆలోచిస్తున్నాడు. విశ్వసిస్తున్నావా? అయితే పరిపూర్ణంగా ఆయన మాట విని ఆయన చిత్తమునకు లోబడి ముందుకు సాగాలని ఆశపడుతున్నావా? అవును అన్నట్లయితే నీ హస్తాన్ని ప్రభువు చూపిస్తావా? మహాపరిశుద్ధుడు అయిన ప్రేమ కలిగిన తండ్రి, గ్రేషియస్ అండ్ హెవెన్లీ ఫాదర్, యు సో లవ్డ్ రూత్ అండ్ యు హ్యావ్ ప్రొవైడెడ్ బోయాజ్ టు టేక్ కేర్ ఆఫ్ హర్, టేక్ కేర్ ఆఫ్ హర్ ఫ్యూచర్, టేక్ కేర్ ఆఫ్ ఫ్యూచర్ నీడ్స్, అండ్ యు హ్యావ్ ప్రొవైడెడ్ ప్రొటెక్షన్, యు హ్యావ్ ప్రొవైడెడ్ ప్రొవిజన్, and you have provided everything that is needed by Ruth. You are such a wonderful God. If only we obey you, if only we depended upon you, if only we submit ourselves to you, you are willing to take care of us and take care of our future and all the needs in job, in family, in health, in everything. You know how to take care of it. As we surrender ourselves into your hands, let your name be glorified and let our future be taken care. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. Devudu ee roju natho maatladadu annavaru unnatlayite devudu mahimparustara. Friends, okka 5 minutes nunchi manam velipabothunnam ee lopata mee chethullo ki mee teeskochu.